Welcome, foolish mortals, to the Haunted Mansion.
On this bonus episode of the Theme Park Duo Podcast, we are celebrating the life and times of Westcoaster.
Prepare yourselves for an unforgettable encounter.
Hi, and welcome to the Theme Park Duo Podcast. Grab your park map, Chiro, and hop in line with us as we take you on a coast-to-coast adventure through the world of theme parks, haunts, conventions, and more. Now, here's your hosts, Nikki and Gabriel.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another fantastic episode of the Theme Park Duo Podcast. I'm your host, Gabe, and noticeably absent is Nikki on this one, and that is because I am joined by some wonderful people as my guests for this very special episode of the Theme Park Duo Podcast. I am joined by no one other than Jim Disney, the founder and owner of Westcoaster.
I'm so sorry.
Welcome to the show.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. I mean, like, I didn't want you on the show, but you kind of forced it on me. So, I mean, like, you're here now.
I didn't want to
be here. So, it is what it is.
Yeah, it's fine.
And then we also have Albert, who is the current caretaker of Westcoaster. Not my choice to say that as his title, but that was his choice.
Hey, guys. I'd say it's a pleasure, but it's a pleasure.
I would hope that it's a pleasure because you're on the show and not, you know, for other reasons, but I digress. It's wonderful to have both of you on. As much as Jim, you sound like you don't want to be here, but it is wonderful to have both of you here. Actually, both your first times on the Theme Park Duo Podcast.
This is true, isn't it? People usually don't ask me to talk ever. So yeah.
Well, that's because you talk without us needing to ask you to talk usually.
Yeah, but mostly, yeah.
Well, we are here today gathered as a group of friends to talk about something that's important to all of us, and that is actually the end of an era, and that is the end of Westcoaster. Now, a lot of people may know Westcoaster as the site that has wonderful photos done by Albert. You know, whenever you want to see these absolutely incredible, crisp, colorful photos, vibrant photos of Haunt or, you know, Disneyland theme parks, you go to Westcoaster for that. If you're an older reader of Westcoaster, you may know it for its sassiness and, you know, kind of ridiculous nature in the way that it talks about themed entertainment. And, you know, according to Jim, they've decided to put that baby to rest, as it were. Now, Jim, from your own mouth, what is kind of the reasoning behind this? Like, how do you feel? What's going on right now?
What do I feel? That's actually a great question. We were basically back in during the haunt season, and you know, Albert and I were having a fairly serious discussion about the future. And the idea of ending Westcoaster because, you know, look, 23 years is a long time for a website to exist.
That's much longer than most websites.
And so, you know, we've been pouring ourselves into this for so long. And I know that everybody knows that I'm just like the stupid guy. Like I'm sassy. I sarcastic. But that was a moment where I'm not joking. We stood out on a sidewalk outside of a home haunt and had a very serious talk, and I cried my freaking eyes off.
Manly guard.
Yeah, absolutely. But it was just, it's just time, you know, everything has a season, right? And so it was a mutual decision. You know, obviously, you know, Dan was involved in the early days, trust me, I did consult with him as well. But we all basically, everybody agreed that Westcoaster has run its course and our lives, both personally and professionally, are leading in directions that mean, you know, we really need to just stop it.
It feels like a natural end to what you've been working on for the past 23 years. It isn't, you know, all of a sudden something happened. It is a feels like a natural ending.
What was nice about it is, you know, there was no conflict about it, you know, because so many times when you see these things end, it's usually because somebody has a problem. But this was, you know, hey, we're all doing good. We're doing better than we ever have been. So here we are. Let's stop.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And for people who may not know what Westcoaster is, which some of our listeners may not, and some of our listeners may know it very well, how would you describe Westcoaster as a website and kind of where it started and how it is now and how it's changed?
That's a two-parter because I'll start it and I'll let Albert feed into it. When we started as the Southern California Coaster Club way, way, way back in the day before.
That sounds like something I have to wear a polo shirt to.
Pretty much. And and so we started the site based off of, what was it? It was Goose's Realm of Insanity or something like that.
Yep.
But Goose's site launched us because we all kind of got together and then we made it into something bigger. And the entire idea was, let's have a coaster club, because at that time Ace was they were the end all be all in the realm. And so we thought, Southern California Coaster Club, yay, we can get into events. And well, that didn't happen. So then I started Westcoaster as the secondary, because it really just, it served itself better as that. And, you know, we did, you know, all of the normal website things. We had the construction updates and all that stuff. But over time, the character, for those that don't know, my name is not Jim Disney. It's something else.
What?
Yeah, I know. But the character of Jim Disney really took over, and it gave me a voice to, you know, go out and, I don't want to say educate, but in some ways educate, but also take the piss out of everybody else. And so it just got goofier and goofier over the years, you know, between me, Dan, and Andrew initially. And I have to give a shout out to Andrew Trawick. He was instrumental in kind of forming the voice as well. So that's kind of how the site started. And then, you know, time gets on and my professional career got in the way. So I had to step away from the site and I handed it off to Albert, and Albert can continue from there.
Yeah, that was around 2016 or so, right? And that was about a little more than a decade and a half after you started the website. And I do remember that you and I had a chat one day and you said, you know, we can't do it any longer. Your professional life is, not going to allow you to do this. And would I take it over for you? And I was just like a little bit floored at the time, but I was honored to do it. And I took it as an opportunity to try to shape the site, honestly, kind of selfishly, as something that might feature things that I was interested in, and kind of expanded a little bit more. And Jim, we talked about once upon a time how Westcoaster had this original mission idea of being kind of like a West Coast lifestyle blog or club or site or something, right? And you know, we focused on roller coasters a lot, but what if we had more? What if you know, we expanded a little bit more on the Halloween content? You know, we'd always covered Knott's, we covered Universal, we started doing Dark Harbor, but what about, you know, some of the other ones? And Myself, you know, I enjoy traveling. I enjoy concerts. What if we had some of that in there, you know, some of that cultural stuff? So that's kind of where it kind of evolved. And, you know, some of that stuff was more successful than others. I think, obviously, we continued doing our theme park stuff, our thematic and attractions and entertainment. In a heck of a lot of haunt content, some of the other stuff.
Definitely.
Some of the travel
stuff. A ton
stuff.
Of haunt content.
Yeah. And so, you know, it just kind of went from there. And I think over time, initially, like when I was trying to shape my own voice a little bit, you know, have my own look into what Westcoaster would become, it was a little bit of everywhere because of all these different things. It kind of coalesced eventually into really just it's a blog about attract themed attractions, right? It's an attractions blog, and it's about all different ways that people can be entertained in immersive, interactive experiences. And that might be theme parks and roller coasters. That could be haunts. That could be some of our, you know, immersive theater events that we've enjoyed going to, all of us. So that's kind of where it became, where it went, and was able to just kind of carve it out from there.
there's definitely a couple things I want to touch upon there. And that's funny because Jim, first of all, the idea of Jim Disney as a persona, as a character, as this voice, I think has stood out much more than I think you ever anticipated, because I've actually saved it, this comment for this recording. And I find it very funny that I was actually at a media event for, I think it was Not Scary Farm at the time. And I was just talking to one of the other guys that got invited there. And he just randomly is like, have you ever heard of this Jim Disney guy? And at the time, I hadn't met you yet. We hadn't gotten as close as we did, as close as we are now. You know, we're very good friends now. And at the time, I was like, I don't know who that is. And he goes, I don't know why he doesn't like me. He always craps on my comments on Twitter.
Okay. So, Norm Gidney, why did you say that?
It wasn't Norm. I don't remember the gentleman's name. It was, he's no longer on the media list. I don't remember his name, but it wasn't Norm. It 100% was not Norm.
Wheels on the bus go round and round.
I just find it funny. Yeah, if whoever it is, if you are listening to this podcast, just know that Jim loves to crap on lots of people's comments, and it's not personal at all.
I'm sure that at the beginning of Theme Park 2, he crapped on us for some reason or another, and I took it as an honor. I took it as an honor, okay?
Right in the face.
I got crapped on my face by Jim Disney.
I very literally left one of the stinkiest poops in the world in your bathroom. So there you are.
Yeah, that's true. So it was that dang pizza you brought over from Topper's Pizza.
It was my fault. I know.
Gosh dang it, man.
Yeah.
Your reputation definitely is definitely known by many of people in the themed entertainment space.
There was a thing recently, well, not recently, it was a haunt season. And, you know, obviously Albert's been running the site, and my wife and I go and hang out with him and, you know, turn his wife into a haunt widow. And
indeed.
Yeah.
I think that's her own fault because she doesn't like scary stuff, right?
She doesn't. My wife.
Yeah, so that's
not
her fault.
Do jump scares at all. Very, very intolerant to jump scares of any like severity or intensity.
That's so intolerant of her.
Yeah. So going back to it, it's been interesting because over the years, we grew the site, we did the thing. You know, there was never any idea of, to be honest, I mean this sincerely, we never thought about like, let's make money off of it. Let's monetize this. Let's go on YouTube or whatever. Like, it just wasn't the idea. The idea was having fun. So we're at this haunt event and Albert introduces me to the guy running the haunt. And he goes, yeah, this is Jim Disney. And I'm sorry, I'm getting a little bit emotional about this. This guy came up to me and said, I grew up reading your site and I love what you did. And that touched me in such a profound way. And so for the idea that I could make somebody laugh, that was wonderful. And, you know, I've moved on, you know, professionally to make people smile in other ways. You know, it's not porn. Don't worry about that.
but okay, it's less goodness. Less smiling and more grimacing, I guess. But I mean, I'm picking up what you're putting down.
No. But yeah, I mean, like the one of the things that's so great about it, and again, the character is something that when people find out, oh, it's you. It's always funny to watch them react because they're like, oh, you're that asshole. But then you also have people, I mean, like there's a kid that I met at Winter Coaster Solace at Knott's 1 year. He and his family came up. Kid was in junior high at that point. He and I have been friends on Facebook for years and years and years, and I've watched him grow up, go to college, get married, have a kid. And to know that in some way I was a part of his life, because he reaches out to me occasionally, to know that I was part of his life and it's been that long, is just, it's profoundly touching. And to Albert's comment about taking the piss out of people, you know, people took it personally sometimes. I'm looking at you, Mice Chat. But
oh, shots fired.
Straight up.
But the thing was that it was never personal. It was satire. It was mocking. It was just making it, like, trying to bring levity to the situation, right? Like, we all were sad when certain things happen, you know, in the parks. But my point was, why are we taking this so seriously? know, it's like,
I mean, it's perspective.
Yeah, things
would definitely
things,
is.
There is nothing in this world that is more certain than death, taxes, and change. So we have to, you know, we have to accept the change first. I don't like to accept the death first and then change. It's kind of hard to do that after you die. But
very, very true. Very, very true.
Yeah, I mean, you could. I mean,
yeah, you lazy.
Yeah,
jeez, work harder.
Yeah.
Jeez.
It says Albert. But yeah, it was never anything really truly personal. It was just, you know, some people took my comments as a jab when it was like, dude, I don't know you from Adam. I saw you make a comment and there you go. You know, here, let me.
Well,
let
you
me.
Know how social media works, man. Like, people exactly. read a comment, there's zero emotional connotation to the words. They read the words and whatever emotion that's in their head, and all of a sudden you're attacking them.
Exactly.
And that's kind of the social media MO that happens quite often. And, you know, I even have to be very careful at times because I'm a rather sarcastic person. And when I comment on Twitter, I try very hard to choose my words carefully so that people don't misconstrue what I'm trying to say. And more often than not, it happens anyway, which is a true testament to how people read into things however they want to.
100%. 100%. You know, laughs, you know, and smiles do not translate through words, you know?
Of course not.
Unless you're like standing in front of somebody. I mean, you and I have had wonderful conversations and, you know, at least you understand the nature of my being. I'm not a mean person. I'm not an angry person. I mean, my goal in life is to make people smile and make people laugh and create memories. So, but some people took it the other way.
And you know what? It's their loss because they didn't get to know somebody that's pretty awesome. But in all honesty, I mean, like, that's, you know, over those many years that you ran Westcoaster, you know, you've only shared like two examples of how many of the people that, you know, communicated to you how they you touched them with the website. Who knows how many more people, dozens, hundreds, thousands of people that have read the website that have you've touched in many different ways with the laugh, with a smile. You know, who knows what kind of day they were having, and you help them out with just maybe a small giggle at something ridiculous in the themed entertainment space. And, you know, even my brother is 7-8 years older than me, you know, knew what Westcoaster was. He's like, oh yeah, I used to read Westcoaster. So even somebody who's outside of the space knew what the website was because he thought it was funny. He thought it was a new angle at talking about these things, and it was interesting. And I think if anything, Westcoaster at least opened up these kind of discussions to people that typically wouldn't be a part of them in the first place.
I really appreciate hearing that.
And I'll be honest, you know, I'm starting, you know, I run the site now, right? But I started out as a reader of Westcoaster, you know, I think back when the Six Flags Building X and Deja Vu and Goliath Jr., I guess, you know, like I was looking for coverage and stuff, right? And Westcoaster was one of the sites that I went onto. It was like, you know, Westcoaster and Twisted Rails and America Coasters Network. But there's just something about Westcoaster that was just the not taking itself seriously, you know, being sarcastic and entertaining. The voice that Jim wrote in, all of it was just really fun. And, you know, back then I was in high school and eventually in college, but I was kind of a fanboy. I started off as a fanboy of Westcoaster, like being like, oh my gosh, like these guys are so entertaining and funny and these guys are cool, you know? And then over time that morphed into a real life friendship that, you know, now Jim is one of my very absolute closest friends. But, you know, to your point, it's like Westcoaster has always been, you know, from the beginning, this voice of, you know, irreverence, just, you know, keeping the fact that this is all a hobby and this is all fun and it's just, you know, it's frivolity, yeah. Right? It's not exactly something we should be taking super serious.
No, not at all. And I mean, I find it interesting that you kind of started as a fanboy, and I feel like that word is kind of like a four-letter word, as it were, in this industry. Like, you're not a foamer, you know what I mean? Like, you were a fan of the site, and then you're handed the reins of the site, you know, after, you know, a decades plus worth of work going into it. How did you feel being handed the reins with a lot of history behind the site?
Well, I felt like I'd finally achieved the American dream, you know, and I think with anything there was a mixture of excitement and trepidation with it. I'm the type of person, like, if I take on something, like, it's got to be something I commit to. It's just like people who know me in real life, people who work with me, they know, like, I'm very meticulous and very focused and very committed toward it. And when Jim, you know, approached me to kind of do this, initially I was kind of like, my gosh, like, how could I ever live up to the reputation and the quality, and how could I ever, like, recreate, you know, Jim's voice and his hilarious, like, rantings and updates and, you know, taking the shit out of things and stuff. I think it was eventually I kind of realized, in with Jim's encouragement, it's like, you know, make Westcoaster, you know, something of my own, right? Like, keep it, you know, the essence of it is not going to change, but, you know, evolve it. And once I saw that as an opportunity, then I became a lot more comfortable. And I think you've seen over the years, number one, I am the person who basically writes like 99% of the updates, but, you know, a lot of it is, it's, you know, it's photographically inclined. It's, you know, expressing my honest opinions. And, you know, like, I'm very supportive of, like, all of the themed entertainment and immersives and attractions, all that kind of stuff. Like, this whole world that we're all, you know, fans of, right? Whether it is theme parks or haunts or theater or performances, like, there are so many creative people who go into this. And so my goal was also just to be very recognizing of them and supportive of them and, you know, try to just showcase the work that they did. And so I think that, like, once I kind of got the confidence of, like, realizing, like, this would be a good way to, you know, turn the direction of Westcoaster, then it was, it kind of, you know, gave me the confidence to just keep on doing it. And, you know, through the time, it's honestly, it's been kind of flattering that Westcoaster has gotten the recognition it has from, you know, both fans and readers, but also I've gotten compliments from insiders, you know, people working at the theme parks, people who are behind the haunts and stuff, of just kind of my voice. And so that's also been kind of a flattering thing as well.
Well, there's definitely a couple things I definitely need to, you know, comment on. And one of them is I think that a lot of people tend to think that, you know, people who cover media events for themed entertainment events tend to do a lot of sucking up and, you know, have to say all these nice things. And I would think that, you know, and Jim, you know, chime in on this if you agree, which I'm expecting him not to chime in because it would be funny if he didn't. But
well.
I think that Albert is a shining example of how you write reviews that are honest, tell the truth, while not completely shitting on an event. And there is this artistry that goes along with writing reviews that allows you to be truthful and honest while not being, you know, overtly blunt about certain situations. And I think, Albert, you do an excellent job with your wordsmithing of these articles, because there's a lot of times that I go to Westcoaster when I'm about to write an article. I'm like, I can never think of how to put something to words as good as Albert does. So I'm going to read what Albert said, and I'm going to think up my own words and how to kind of formulate what I want to say, because I always felt like you are so eloquent with how you talk about the themed entertainment space. So I would say that you definitely have made Westcoaster your own and, you know, highlighted a lot of things that, you know, maybe didn't happen prior to you and, you know, made it very unique and, you know, very much more Albert. And I love both, you know, iterations of the website. You have the irreverent side and you have like this, you know, very much photo forward, gorgeous photos with eloquent descriptions of everything. So I definitely think that you found your own.
Thank you, Gabe. And I appreciate that you have also admitted on your podcast that you plagiarize Westcoaster. So,
and, yeah. Oh, often. All the time.
We all know that you're basically taking Westcoaster posts, running it through ChatGPT. And, yep. But, you know, in terms of like the sucking up thing, trust me, yeah, I'm, oh my God. I've never had to do that. And I'll tell you the reason. This is not coming from a point of arrogance, but very early on, we made friends with Jack Falfus, who is the general manager of Knott's Berry Farm at the time. And I will credit that man as being one of my favorite mentors in life. He and I still stay in contact, and he's wonderful. I remember after he left Cedar Fair, I called him one day, and if you're hearing this, you said this. I called him one day. I said, "Hey, Jack, how you doing?" He goes, "I'm playing golf, getting fat." So, yeah, it's you know, the suck up factor was never a thing with us. We just, I think, beyond the sarcasm and all the fun stuff like that, we honed in on the relationships that we had inside the industry. And so I'm giving a card away here. But I, you know, I've been doing this for a long time, and there were just people that I could talk to, and I would have weekly talks with him, and what really put Westcoaster on the map was to allow us to shoot the teardown of Windjammer at Knott's. And so, because, you know, everybody loved that ride.
May she rest in pieces.
What a classic.
Oh, it was so good. It was just butter on the rails, man. So
true, the true Togo treasure.
It was in all
places right now because of that ride.
Yeah. Yeah. It's actually, you know, it's funny enough. I found out, because a piece of paint chipped off the hood of my, on the inside of my Mazda. And, I realized that it was actually a piece of, windjammer, which is really funny. So it's basically been melted down and it's nothing now. but I have to thank
C'est la vie.
Yeah, but I have to thank Knott's Berry Farm profusely for always everybody there in their management has always been so supportive and so kind to us, even though sometimes we didn't deserve it. But they were always kind to us and always looped us in on things and, you know, included us in media events, you know, when other people weren't. And so they were the real, like, I guess if you want to say the foundation of what Westcoaster became, it was because of Knott's Berry Farm.
That makes a lot of sense. You know, you get your footing in there, you're able to do the coverage, and then you start making the name for yourself. And, you know, before we move on to like some other topics, you know, I definitely want to say that, you know, I think Westcoaster was a big inspiration for a lot of people and continues to be. And I think that says a lot about the content that you put out, Jim, and as well as you, Albert. You know, the fact that I'm sitting here and saying, like, I pretty much hold Albert's articles up to the highest regard. That, you know, that comparatively to anybody else writing articles about the themed entertainment space right now says a lot.
Well, now I'm blushing.
no, it's just a whiskey.
You know what's funny?
I do not actually get Asian glow. Fun fact.
You don't?
I do not that get wasn't Asian even glow.
It wasn't really an Asian glow comment, but you made it that. But,
Well, sorry.
But you're the one that made it racist.
Damn
you,
it.
You know, yeah, you self-racism. What the hell, Albert? So the funny part about that comment is Gabe's comment is that the site started, you know, with basically it was me, Dan, Andrew, and our friend Mike. But Dan was the original photographer. Well, he and I both kind of traded off. But he... He was shooting the original updates on an HP 315 digital camera that, you know, it ran off of AA batteries and would give you maybe about 2-3 hours of life. And so we were constantly having to carry batteries around in our pockets just so we could, you know, go through the day and like actually shoot an update. But and
back
of
in
course,
the day, though, you guys wore jean shorts and cargo pants or cargo shorts.
I still wear cargo shorts.
There might be a
I'm sorry.
Floating around there of you three, of you and Dan and Andrew rocking those things back in the day that, you know, might you be really- pretty incriminating these days.
We love embarrassing photos here. Yeah, we love them.
Albert, you're fired.
Oh, it's a good thing that I'm...
The site's going down, so it's fine.
You can't fire me. I quit, literally.
Yeah, exactly. But I mean, that's so funny that you even bring that up, Albert. You know, like, the fashion change, but also that's, you know, a fun memory of, you know, being at the parks and having to do those things because that's just how it was at the time. And I'm sure you guys have thousands, hundreds of fun stories and memories from the parks and doing updates that you could probably share with us here. I'll start off one of my favorite memories. And this is actually of one of Albert's articles. And this is actually quite recent. And it stays in my head because it makes me laugh so hard every time I think about it. And I believe that you were taking photos of the backstage maze over at Knott's Scary Farm from the tower. you know, the rotating lookout tower at Knott's.
Sky Cabin, yeah.
And you saw, yeah, and you saw the, yeah, Sky Cabin. You saw the all the black walls, and you said in your article that Knott's Scary Farm was building their own Halloween Horror Nights maze with all the black walls. And I still to this day cannot not laugh at that, because it's one of the funniest things I've ever read on any website about themed theme parks and themed entertainment. And, you know, I definitely think with that comment alone, you've kept that irreverence alive to a certain extent.
It's a miracle I wasn't kicked off Universal's mailing list after that comment, right? But I mean, maybe that just means they weren't reading it.
It was a joke. It was a joke. It's silly.
It is. And you know,
it's all in good fun. It's all in good fun.
Any reasonable person, I would think, would recognize that. And, you know, I mean, it is. That's, you know, like I tried to play a poor man's gym by occasionally trying to exercise my humor funny bone in my writing. I could never do it as well as he did. But, you know, sometimes when the inspiration strikes, it's there.
Yes, exactly.
Or the perspiration. Or so, yeah. So speaking to the memories, you know, I've brought up Andrew a couple times. Not only did he design some of the early logos for Westcoaster, but he was the one that would make me laugh harder than any other person. He also pissed me off more than any other person, but
it's funny how that goes hand in hand a lot of the time, right?
Seriously, right? And but you know, we used to go to DCA all the time, and you know, get a couple drinks in us, and he would throw himself down the nets of the Redwood Creek Challenge Trail. I'm shocked that we never got thrown out of the park.
Just like running through it drunk?
Oh, yeah, pretty much.
Just falling on purpose?
No, he just somersaulted all the way down. And I'm like, God. How did you not kill yourself?
Yeah, how do you not break your neck doing that? I break my neck nearly walking through it with my four-year-old. Are you kidding me?
Oh, seriously. Yeah, I can't even chew gum and walk at the same time. So, I mean, it's all good. The other
it's
thing,
a miracle you could talk.
Some would say. The other thing that thinking about memories, Dan used to have this thing. It was a hand on a stick. We called it Norm.
A hand on a stick.
Yeah. We called it Norm. No arm.
No. Oh, no arm.
It had nothing to do with Norm, who you all know I love. But. Yeah, so we had no arm, and we would walk around DCA and Disneyland, and one of us had to hold it up like remember the tour guides that used to walk around with the flags?
Oh my gosh.
I don't know this story. so you know in the old days, you know, you would have these tour groups that would come in and they would be guided. And they would have a flag. And so they're walking through the park with these flags. And so we thought it would be really funny to just walk around with this, you know, plastic hand on a stick. No joke. Like just a dowel. And see if people could follow us. I swear to God.
I'm surprised you weren't.
Did it work?
Kicked out of that.
I swear to God, it worked.
That's like just as good as the VIP maze at Scary Farm. Oh. Just nearly as good as that.
Same That's idea. Yeah. yeah. Same idea.
Yeah.
So,
which, by the way, if you don't know what I'm referencing, people, the VIP maze, the monsters essentially made their own sign that said VIP maze, started a line. There was no VIP maze. There was no maze. So people were standing in line for nothing.
I mean, people did that for Superstar Limo.
Oh, good, valid point. Very valid point. I mean, I wanted to see Drew Carey, but other than that, I guess nothing.
How about a
nothing
map to your house, Drew Carey? Okay, insider story. Funny story about that ride was when they were in Test and Adjust. Before they had the shells for the vehicle, they actually... Okay. Am I breaking an NDA? No. So
we're all friends, DA.
Well, no. I'm thinking, is this going to get me in a
legally?
Is this going to get me in a rehire? So basically, what happened was they built a before they got the fiberglass shells on the car, you know, that, you know, we all know and hate. They built a plywood and 2x4 built box and put a toilet seat on it. and that was the way that they programmed that damn ride. And I swear to God, it's one of I've still got the photo. It's like a no joke. This was pre-digital. It's 35 millimeter.
Man, but that explains so much about that ride.
If that's not foreshadowing, I don't know what is.
Oh no. Everybody that worked on that ride knew how bad it was going to be. And so that's why it was literally a toilet seat. They were like, sorry, this ride's going to be shit.
And right they were. Man, that's I'm just trying to picture it in my head, and right now I just have a hard time picturing Superstar Limo. All I think about is Monsters Inc. and thinking about going through Monsters Inc. on a toilet, and that's quite funny to me.
I would do it.
I mean, I would. I mean, that's the best themed bathroom experience I've ever heard of.
Pretty much, yeah. Yeah, I would agree.
I mean, it's the best anti-constipation medicine ever, right? Just go on Superstar Limo.
Pretty much.
You know, along with fun memories, you know, obviously includes a lot of good friendships. You know, I would say that, you know, you've connected with a lot of people over your time working on Westcoaster. You know, Albert, me, Greg from Park Journey, Dan, Andrew, lots of people. Who are other people that are notable, at least in the lifespan of what Westcoaster was for you?
Well, I'm going to start actually with a story about Dan. The very first time that I met him, he was a reader. He was an SCC, you know, guy. And then he texted me, he messaged me or emailed me, I guess, back in the day, and was like, "Hey, I'm going to be at Disneyland with my sister. I'd like to meet you." And I straight up pulled a Bruno on him, Encanto reference, of course. And, you know, it was 10 minutes tops. It was so awkward because I'm naturally a shy person, which is strange to hear right now.
Right.
But no, I'm not
it's
like.
It's true, though. It is true.
But I'm not. That's true. I'm not interacting face to face with people I don't know. You know, I can't pretend a stranger is a long-awaited friend. You know, and so we talked for like 10 minutes, and I was like, I straight up Bruno'd him, and I was like, I gotta go. You know, to your point. I have one of my best friends. His name is David. He lives in Houston now, but he grew up in Adelaide, Australia. He started reading the site pretty early on. And then he and the woman who is now his wife, they ended up working for a Carnival Cruise Line. And they were ported out of L.A. And so that's how we met. Like face to face, and whenever they had like the overnight, or they didn't have, you know, what they call IPM or import manning, which basically means you have to stay on the ship when you're in port. They would come to Disneyland, and so we would hang out. And then there's Ian, who he started. And this is a fun story. He actually had the first out-of-country West Coaster meetup in Australia.
That's kind of cool.
Yeah, they were in the Gold Coast. So, you know, they've got a couple parks over there. And they went to the Warner Brothers Movie World Park, and there were like four or five guys that read Westcoaster, and just all Australians. For whatever reason, they thought that we were cool.
Were they wrong?
Well, they're upside down on the other side of the world, so you know it's everything's just messed up down there.
Yeah, their toilets go the opposite way.
It's true. That's true facts.
I mean, I had to pay him for it, though, too, so whatever.
Well, an undisclosed sum for which you will not be, you know, sued for, right?
$5. Pretty much.
Yeah, okay.
But, you know, Ian in particular, I have to single him out because when my wife and I got married, Ian was not on contract. Strangely enough, being Australian, he also works in the cruise industry. It's almost a rite of passage. It kind of like, you know how Mormons go on their missions? Australians go to the cruise.
Yeah. I think he fought a dingo first and then he got on the cruise ship.
Pretty
and
much.
A kangaroo. Those buff ones. Much.
Yeah.
So
the APAC and stuff.
Yeah, right. But I do have to call him out in the best way possible, because when my wife and I were getting married, he was off contract and he flew from Australia all the way to Los Angeles and was there for my bachelor party. And that's the kind of guy that he is. And these are the kinds of friendships that we've formed over the years, whether it be, you know, Wes, you know, I mean, back in the day, if you're an old reader of Westcoaster, you remember Westcoaster, or, you know, Luke used to do the stuff from Northern California. But, you know, people, and again, people like Ian and David, obviously Albert, you know, who I met after we started, and I think that my first interaction with Albert too was also very awkward, but it's shocking. I know.
I think it was, because it was the Silver Bullet, Knott's Berry Farm Silver Bullet opening day or preview, whatever, media day. It was the media day for Silver Bullet. That was the first time we actually met in person.
If I'm not mistaken, it was right after I was cornered by a reporter. I forget what outlet they were from. And they were asking me, you know, questions. And then I come down the stairs of the exit and Albert was just happened to be there and was like, "Hey, are you Jim Disney?" And, you know, and I was like, yeah.
And he goes, "Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God."
And then I started tapping my head like, and then I Bruno'd him. So
I gotta go.
Yeah, pretty much.
That sounds about right.
But it's honestly been amazing. You know, obviously you, Greg, I could name so many people that have been so kind. I mean, you know, getting just random emails, like you said earlier, about people who were like, you know, my grandma just died, but you wrote this thing and it made me laugh. So that's the kind of stuff that I loved, and I'll miss that. I hope now that the other things that I do give them good memories as well.
And I guarantee you they do. Guarantee you that they do. And I feel like, you know, we are talking about the end of Westcoaster, but I don't necessarily think that means that, you know, these memories of fun moments connected to Westcoaster, the friendships built over, you know, the creation of Westcoaster, or even the highlights or any of it takes away from it. I think if anything, the ending of Westcoaster makes all of those things so much more strong than they were before. You know, we look back on these moments fondly and look at how much they've impacted our lives, changed who we are as a person, and informed a lot of what we're doing today. And I think that is pretty astounding that a lot of amazing things have come out of a silly website talking about themed entertainment and roller coasters. And look at you now. Both of you, you've gained so many things that are priceless.
I'm not going to pay your therapy bills. Any of you, please do not look me up. This is
but
why
I'll
I'm
see Jim, you next Thursday, right?
This
I'll
is why I'm Jim Disney, and you don't know me. I'm not paying your therapy bills.
See you next Thursday. Same time, same place?
11 o'clock, man.
That back alley, right? Perfect. Back alley one?
Yep, back alley.
Yeah.
Exactly. I'll bring the boysenberry jelly. And, you know, of course, you know, I feel like those fun memories and highlights are kind of the same thing, but you and Albert must have like your number one highlight of working on Westcoaster. For both of you, what is that number one highlight from running the site?
Does it have to be the same highlight? Because you're putting me on the spot.
No,
right
it doesn't.
Now.
No, it doesn't. It doesn't have to be the same highlight. It can be a completely different highlight, and you should feel like you're on the spot because you are.
Gabe, with those tough hitting questions, I'm gonna defer to Jim first because I got to think about this.
I'm expecting one of them to be the moment that you met Gabe at theme park.
That was going to be one of them, but since you
that
mentioned,
actually
it,
the
no,
moment
I'm
we met
Nikki, talk about it.
Not Gabe. Yeah,
son
because
of
she's so much more charming. And
as she drinks her wine and falls asleep on the couch next to me.
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, that's charming AF.
That's true.
So one of the things that I can point out is that's how I met the person that I eventually married. She and I were at a, we had a bunch of mutual friends. It's all Albert's fault. And he was like, hey, we're going to do this thing. And this cute chick was there. And, you know, at the time we were both in relationships. So it was off the table, obviously. But years later, we found each other in a place where we were both single. And we were like, hey, I like you. and then, you know, we started dating. And of course, you know, now she was dumb enough to say yes when I asked her to marry me. And then let's see, what would be another one? Oh, you know,
that fun thing that Albert invited you to was, did he say, now everybody turn your pineapples upside down?
Yeah. Right. The other one that I would say, actually there's two. And again, we're circling back to Knott's Berry Farm here. The first one would have been Dan and I when Accelerator was opening. We got our own train. We were and we were the last people out. And
that's pretty dope. That's pretty cool.
Purposefully, they let us have our own train before the public got to ride, and that was fun. And then again, when Silver Bullet opened, we did exactly the same thing. But there were at that point, because B&M, there were four of us. Both of those were very good days.
I mean, those are pretty good highlights. Can you follow up to that, Albert?
No,
can you follow
I really can't. I can't say that I met my wife because of Westcoaster, although I do have to give a shout out to my loving wife, who is very patient with all the time that I've spent on Westcoaster, whether it be a haunt widow at home when I go to scary things, or you know, when I'm at theme parks or like Knott's events, a lot of those, and dragging her around to the festivals and things like that. I don't know. I honestly was trying to think of like a number one highlight event, and it's just really tough because, you know, there's just been a lot of great experiences. I think, you know, taking over West Coast Crew, kind of playing the media card, it's been, it's always been fun because every time we're in an event, it's like this big family reunion with, you know, other bloggers and media members, quote unquote, right? You know, be hanging out with people like you and Nikki, Gabe, and Greg from Park Journey, you know, Norm and Jeff from Horror Buzz. And then especially during Halloween time, it's like a big thing too. So it's like, you know, Halloween Every Night and Parks and Cons. And then, of course, my haunt twin, Warren, who, you know, some people occasionally confuse for me, but we are not the same person. But Warren from Hollywood Gothic, got to give a shout out there.
I think you mean other Albert.
It's just other Albert. Yes, yeah, it's just other Albert.
I can't say that, but...
I mean, I feel like you should be able to, and we shouldn't be able to. I feel like that's how it should go.
I suppose so. You're just trying to sow discord, because then we're gonna have to feud for like the supreme Asian haunt blogger guy or something, you know, like Highlander, but like
battle to the death,
spooky and Asian. I don't know. That's been every time that's happened, you know, especially like the media nights or media evenings and days and stuff, that's always been a lot of fun. I think, you know, for me, a lot of them are kind of connected to haunt. Number one, because I'm just a huge nerd for all Halloween stuff. And number two, because I am proud of what we've been able to build at Westcoaster for that. But, you know, being able to get invites for a lot of the more exclusive things like, you know, Horror Nights, we're actually kind of off their list for a little bit and kind of got back on it. And things like Delusion and JFI, their productions, just being able, just being privileged enough to be able to like attend those events, I think we're just really, you know, really, really thrilling. And then a lot of times there's just like little moments where, you know, if I'm at a park and someone like recognizes me and says, hey, you know, really enjoy what you do and really love what you write about. You know, I've never been a person who's like, oh, like I'm the person that people go to or people listen to. So it's just, that's all very strange to me when people like, quote unquote, recognize me or, lather compliments, because I'm semi uncomfortable with that notion. Like I'm a very much perfectionist. I'm very Asian and I'm very like, you know, want to do a good job on everything and do well. But at the same time, I'm like, I can't take any compliments because, you know, you got to stay humble and stuff. So it's always been very flattering when people are like, hey, like we really enjoyed, you know, when you talked about this or wrote about that or and stuff. And again, like I mentioned that earlier, it goes from all deals. It's like, you know, fans have done it. You know, I've talked to, you know, insiders, you know, people like Ken Parks at Knott's and Cedar Fair, you know, talking to him and chatting about Ghost Town Alive and, you know, his appreciation for my thoughts and commentary on the event. You know, that's just kind of like, oh, wow, like these people who are, you know, like much in charge of much more important things than I am, like they're actually hearing me. So I think things like that, I think are to me, like it's what I would consider my highlights, because it's just fun to like know that someone has heard your voice, just, you know, like,
yeah. I mean, honestly, like I can't tell you how many times I've been to, you know, an event where they're showing us photos and in the bottom right hand corner, it says Westcoaster on it, you know, and I'm like, that's Albert's photos. Every single time. Yeah. So if you're listening to this and you're going to Midsummer Scream, you go into a panel, you see some photos up there and it says Westcoaster, that's Albert's photo. And the fact that people in the industry are using your photos as representation for their events, I think speaks volumes about the quality product that you put out, Albert. So,
yeah,
you know, it speaks a lot. And I find it funny when people recognize you, because whenever I see you in the fog, all I see is your forehead. Because you're hiding behind your camera. I know that forehead. Anywhere. That's Albert. I know that forehead.
It is incredibly humbling. And I'm flattered and I'm honored that when people do think that way. And I appreciate it. And I think there is the power of photography to kind of be able to transport you and kind of give you, you know, bring joy and by depicting something, right? And just the certain way that it's depicted. And it kind of stirs up emotions, right? A photograph can kind of remind you of a memory of how something was. Or, you know, you look at a picture of Fog Alley in Ghost Town. And if you've been through that, then you can hear the screams, you can hear the sliders, you know, scraping against the pavement. You can smell that. Exactly. You can smell that fog juice, right? Like, so, you know, I've always striven to try to bring that to people. And then for the people who can't go to Knott's every time, you know, it's kind of like living a little bit vicariously, but if that has you know, brought joy or brought entertainment, you know, brought something positive to people. That's what I've wanted to do as well. So, you know, kind of similar goes to Jim, but just in a little bit of a different way.
And I definitely think that you succeeded in doing that. I think you do a fantastic job at doing that. Jim has done a fantastic job at doing that. I before we move on to our last few things that we want to talk about, you know, I do want to say that, you know, we put a lot of work into this stuff. You know, Jim has put endless hours into Westcoaster. Albert's put endless hours into Westcoaster. You know, the blogger space is not an easy thing to do. It's a lot of hard work, and a lot of it is driven by the passion for the topic and for the subject matter. And, you know, it'll be February, and Albert's like, oh, I have these three updates on these three haunts that I visited out in October, because he's still releasing stuff about things because he visited so many that he's still editing photos. So, you know, I think that just is a proven dedication to what you're doing.
Well, I think it's mostly because Albert's an insomniac
perfectionist.
And you know, so all I can attest to was the site. It required a lot of blood, sweat, and booze. So,
oh yeah.
But I mean, he has done such an amazing job, and I'm so proud of the photographer that he's become. And he, you know, and the writing,
it's all thanks to you, technically.
I mean, yeah.
Hear that? It's all your fault.
Read my goodbye post for more details. Hashtag.
It is literally my fault that everybody has to put up with him. But it's been a journey in that regard. But Albert, when we decided to kind of hand over the reins, you know, it was just a natural thing. It was like he was the only person that I could think that would go in and do things the way that I would want them to be. And he found his own voice while keeping the humor up, you know, and it was, he's done such a great job.
Thank you, man.
Applause.
Applause. No, it's thank you so
don't
much.
Do too much. The gods might get angered by all the celebrating.
We've already been storming, so you know.
Ah, valid point.
Wasn't there like a tornado today or something?
Yeah, in Montebello, this is a tornado.
So
it's because Westcoaster's closing. Everything's going crazy.
That's true. I
have to make a note that if you see Albert in the parks,
I'm probably behind the camera.
I'm telling you right now. Well, yeah, you're going to see his forehead. But the one thing that I will say, and I mean this very sincerely, is that if you see Albert in the parks, you buy him a freaking drink. He should not have to pay for another drink in the parks for the rest of his life. The guy is that good.
For all 17 of you sentiment. Readers who are listening to this, keep that in mind. Thanks.
I think you mean seven.
That's bad.
Yeah, probably. But I think we're kind of coming to the end of our conversation here, you know, talking about the life and the history of Westcoaster and the meaning behind it for, you know, the people behind the camera, behind the computer, and talking about the messages you've received from people and the meaning or the impact it's had on them. And, you know, we kind of touched upon how it felt like this was a natural end to what Westcoaster has become because, you know, personal lives get in the way, personal goals that you want to achieve, and time to, as you put it, Jim, put the baby to bed. What would be your final thoughts and ideas around Westcoaster? And if someone, and I'll put it in this context, if somebody were to be reading an article that talks about Westcoaster, how would you want it to be described and put that into kind of your final thoughts?
It's, I guess the best way to say it is never trust a fart, you know,
what?
Never trust a fart.
And sometimes they're tricky. Sometimes they're more than a part, I mean, sometimes they're a little
little tutor with a little turtle head going on.
Did I say my question?
Yeah, I understand the question. I think that's exactly the question you asked. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Perfect.
Pretty much. Okay. So the serious answer is, if I was on the other side of the mirror and I was writing about Westcoaster, I would just want to express that, again, going back to something that I said earlier, it's just about trying to bring joy to people's lives, period, end of story. That's all I've wanted to do. I've wanted to entertain people in that regard. I wanted to bring theme park fans the stuff that they wanted to see, but do it in a way that at the time nobody else did it. And so, like, I was photoshopping a monkey blowing up dynamite in photos of dirt and what we call them noodles. With the rebar, you know, as they're building like the footers for a roller coaster, or the rabbits. I don't know if anybody's been around that long.
Gosh, but, yeah.
it was trying to take the mundane and make it weird and interesting and funny, because look, coaster people, especially in the theme park world, when a ride is going up, once the ride, like, even let's say Galaxy's Edge, you know, once the ride box goes up, they're like, I'm out, you know, but when they're digging in the dirt, they're all in. But how do you make that interesting? So, and how do you make it fun? Because that's really dumb.
It is dirt. At the end of the day, we are moving dirt.
Yes, it is.
All we're doing is moving dirt around. And then all of a sudden, there's some concrete there.
Oh my God, so exciting.
And then it's placed in a certain way. So that must mean this, right? And there's a pit. Oh my gosh, right? What does that mean?
And so I guess the bottom line, that, like, if I was to put a bottom line on Westcoaster, again, it's just that we endeavored over the years, 23 years, over half of my life, to
dating yourself.
Oh, I am.
Yeah, old fart.
Yeah,
I'm incredibly old.
Oldest one.
He said, "Don't trust a fart." He said it.
Yeah,
just saying.
You know this from personal experience.
Yeah, I shat my pants once. So
not a conversation we're having.
So no, I think that it was about entertaining people and giving them something to enjoy. And you know, I know that in this world of billions of people, no joke, that this is okay, we're getting into serious town. If I died tomorrow, nobody apart from the people that know me would care. But beyond that, Westcoaster was able to touch so many more people between myself and what Albert's done. And again, like I said, the idea was just to entertain them. And for those people that are out there who might be listening to this, thank you. And I hope that you had fun with us. And I'm sorry to have to, you know, pull the plug on it.
I think I'll pile on a little bit, but I think, you know, Westcoaster is, you know, obviously a site celebrating the mania and the fandom of theme parks and roller coasters, but just going about it in a non-serious way, right? Capturing the fun. I think for me, you know, I tried to tack on to that, but being a photographer and being a person who enjoys writing, I think I wanted to bring people along for the journey and the ride and for them to have fun, you know, virtually, again, for the people who couldn't do it or for the people who had been there, but they wanted to relive it. She probably should have mentioned this earlier, but once upon a time, one of my big influences was Bob Coker from Thrill Ride and the way he wrote about how you went on a roller coaster and what that was like. And the way his words, it was like you were there. It was like you were writing it, you know, like on his website, you know, and he published a book as well. Right. And yeah,
I got to interrupt you, but never trust a guy who puts the picture of Windjammer on the front cover of his book.
To be fair, he is not perfect. And that is probably the most glaring flaw in an otherwise pretty fantastic book.
Look, Robert Coker, he's an amazing friend and an amazing human being. So I'm just
love again, hearing him scream as he goes through haunts.
Yeah,
it's probably the best.
Yep,
that's true. Yep. It's comically and almost satirically hilarious. I must say
it's amazing, is what it is.
But you know, going back to the way his voice was, like the way I write is a very journalistic style. The way I document overall, even though like I do strive to create like really nice pictures and pretty photos and everything, but it's very documentarian. And goodness knows anyone who's read any of my updates, they're long. There's a lot of words. There's a lot of photos. But in and of itself, all of that is, to kind of bring you there. And so if that was successful, that was able to bring you joy, then I'm glad, I'm happy to do that. Because it's similar to Jim, what Jim was saying, at the end of the day, our goal was to put a smile on someone's face. And Jim's style was being just goofy and silly and ridiculous and, writing things that were like just hysterically, brilliantly, ingeniously just bizarre, off the wall, right? And my style was a little bit more kind of, I guess, not as crazy, but like, kind of informational and, eye candy and stuff like that. But at the end of the day, it was still, very similar goals. So, if you followed along for everyone, I have to say as well, thank you to everyone who has followed along. Thank you to the people who've stopped me in the parks and expressed appreciation. Thank you to the people who've commented online. Thank you to the, friendships I made both in person and on the interwebs. It's all been, truly an honor to be able to, bring our passion to other like-minded people who appreciate and enjoy it.
And Albert, by the way, to your comment about me, checks in the mail.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
I'll say this. Now that West Coaster is gone, who am I going to play Drez now? Who do I move on to now to cannibalize their articles?
America Coaster Network.
There you go. Maybe.
They don't even write articles. They're just on social media.
Yeah.
I guess I'll just close shop too.
You should look up this website called Absolutely Reliable News and Rumors. I think they're really spot on what they report.
I'm sure.
Except for the fact that I don't think they're active anymore. So that joke just fell flat. Anyway.
Good job. That's the way to end an episode. I'll tell you that much.
But, not with a boom, but with a fart.
Yes, exactly. I think of anything. But, I want to thank both of you for coming on the show today to chat about your feelings, your emotions, your stories, and your history with Westcoaster. And, I think it's an honor to be one of your guys' friends, but also it's an honor to have you guys on here and talk about something that's so meaningful to both of you. And, as much as it is sad that something like this is coming to an end, it is amazing to be able to have had those experiences. And now we have this episode to look back at and to kind of enjoy, to hear our emotions and thoughts about the ending of Westcoaster when it was happening. And, thank you to both of you for what you've done on Westcoaster. And just thank you for, giving me the opportunity to talk to you two about it as well.
Thank you, Gabe, for having us. It's been an honor.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
Jim, you could put the gun down now because I said my part, right? I said my part.
It checks in the mail.
Okay, cool. Just checking. But in sincerity, I appreciate both of you. Thank you for putting so much effort and love into Westcoaster, and off to the annals of history, as it were.
I think you mean the annals of history.
Seriously, come on! You had with a fart. Jeez, come on.
I'm the serious one here. I have to be the straight one. You know what I mean?
You got
to
do the podcast.
You guys are the comedy. Podcast interviewer. You, jeez.
Yeah, you're all respectful.
The guy who said don't drop F-bombs right before we started recording. Yeah, of course.
We get one right again. It's PG-13. We get one F-bomb. Damn it!
Gosh, damn. Well, all right. I wanted that.
You can Bastard. Have another one. Go for it right now.
No, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that. They're going to kick you off everything.
We can fix it in post.
You son of a bitch.
Well, everybody that knows me knows that I use the F word as like an apostrophe.
Same here in real life. And we all know that, studies have been done that people who are cursed the most are the people that are the most intelligent. Just saying.
And attractive, I think, too. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's super hot and funny.
Super
and, like, good at writing articles and taking sexy photos.
Yeah,
super
like
sexy. Super duper sexy.
Run the best websites, too.
Yes. Yeah, of course.
Not a joke at all.
I definitely think this is where we're going to be ending this week's episode. It has devolved into our own patting of our own backs. But once again, thank you guys so much for joining us on this episode of Theme Park Duo. Is there anywhere that people can follow you? I know, Jim, you might be off of social media at this point because Westcoaster is going to be no more, but do you guys want to share where people can follow your current adventures?
I am not doing anything that would
necessitate people to follow you.
That's very true.
Yes.
So
he's doing illegal things. Do not follow him, please.
So yeah, if you see me in the park and you know who I am, don't feel free to say hi. That's fine.
He'll Bruno you though.
I will Bruno you. But I just want to leave everybody with one parting word.
There you go. That's a very, very appropriate usage of the word.
I will say, I guess, if you want to follow me on my Instagrams at Disney Photoblography for pretty pictures of Disney stuff, and at Haunt Photoblography for pretty pictures of Halloween stuff. Hashtag
there you go.
Plug whatever. Anyway, I'm new to this.
Well, it's the plug yourself part of the episode. So it's welcomed and deserved. But thank you guys again for being on this episode. Thank you for everybody for tuning into this very special episode of the Theme Park Duo podcast. As we always say, if you want to support the show in a free way, make sure you head on over to iTunes and leave us a 5-star review. It's a free way to support the show. It brings us up higher in the standings and makes it easier for everybody to find us and follow us and enjoy us like you are right now. If you want to follow us on social media, you can follow us at Theme Park Duo on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and TikTok, and YouTube. All of our podcasts go up on there, so you can check us out there. If you want to email us comments, questions, concerns, anything that you guys want to tell us about this episode or any other episodes, things you want to hear, things you don't want to hear, you can always email us at themeparkduo@gmail.com. And as always, everyone, thank you again. And always remember, there's always a great, big, beautiful tomorrow. See ya.
Thanks for riding with the Theme Park Duo. Make sure to gather all your belongings before the end of the podcast. Bye-bye.
Secrets time. Keys on ice.